Without further ado, we would like to welcome to the stage here at North Cross School, Dr. Terrell Strayhorn.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Round of applause for that wonderful introduction. My esteemed pleasure to be here at North Cross High School to have the opportunity to speak to so many really wonderful students, bright minds who are excited about what we're about to talk about, who are not just the world of tomorrow and our future, but the world of right now. And so before I get into too many of the comments that I want to share with you this afternoon, I do want to say special thanks to a couple of folks, and then I want to move pretty swiftly into the things that I hope to cover this afternoon. Is that okay? So first, a special thanks to the headmaster of this school. Please a round of applause for Dr. Proctor. And to the Dean of Academics, Ms. Deborah Jessen, a round of applause. Clap for yourself because you look so great. Look at the person to your left. Look them straight in the eye. To your left, to your left, to your left. You gotta find somebody. Look at the person beside you. Okay, you gotta look straight in the eye. Make it look awkward, right? So stare, stare, stare. And then just tell them, repeat after me. Say, I love your face. I could go. Like most good speakers and instructors, I have more to say than I have time to say. I understand my assignment in visiting your campus is to highlight, celebrate, talk about Black History Month. Secondly, my assignment is to do it in a way that relates to all of us. So how do you talk about Black history to a diverse group of students and faculty and staff in the year 2017? We're about to embark upon that activity. So talk about Black history, but in a way that makes it relevant to each and every one, regardless of grade level, regardless of race, class, gender, sexual orientation, race, affiliation, height, weight, all those different dimensions that make us uniquely ourselves, but also different. And then third, and this one I got directly, from our phone call, our prep call, is to do it in a way that keeps your attention, and then you leave also inspired and motivated. So, no pressure here. Tall assignment for a short guy. That's okay, because I like to describe myself as not short, but the fun size. Any other fun size people in the audience? Fun size folks? Come on, here's the fun size folks. So all of that was what I knew I had to do before I ever got on the plane to make my way to Virginia from Ohio. But here's the other part, and I'm a speaker and a person who believes that part of my life I have control over. There's part of my life that I planned. I planned that my tie and my shoes would sort of kind of relate to one another. In fact, I had it so well designed that I was going to have a flower lapel that also was this color, but I forgot to pack it somehow. So forgive me for that. It'll come the next time I come back, right? So I've already invited myself back and haven't even said anything to you. But there's another part of my life that I think over which I have no control. I don't know why. I think this is true for everyone. I don't know why it happens, but it just so happens that on the same day that I know I got to talk about these issues, something interesting has happened that I think underscores the importance of this conversation, but also gives me a little bit of a runway for the conversation I want to have with you today. Before I go too far into those comments, that moment that I'm talking about, I shared with two really wonderful people who have joined me here today. So I'm Terrell Strayhorn, Professor and Director of the Center for Higher Education Enterprise at The Ohio State University. The Center for Higher Education Enterprise is a research center focused on student success. So your success is part of our agenda. It's what drives us to be here all the time. We're delighted to form collaborations and partnerships with high schools. But I'm joined by two members of our dynamic team who are here in the room. So our communications specialist, Shay Merite, is in the back. Shay, wave your hands. The facility back. And also our policy analyst and researcher, Dr. Rory L. Johnson, is in the back. Good looking guy with a hat on. We require it. It's part of the screening process. I'm joking. We have lots of people at Chief who don't look good. I'm kidding there. So this is delighted they can join us. We were just making our way from Blacksburg, Virginia to Roanoke. And so we didn't bring cars. When you don't bring a car, nowadays you rely on rideshare apps like Uber and Lyft, and there are a number of others that are developing. In fact, because we are the way we are, and I got to say the things I have to say in order for us to get where we got to get in the time I have available. So believe it or not, if you look online, you Google anything, you can Google. There are people right now, there's actually one in Chicago that's developing a mobile app, an all-black mobile app. It's a mobile app founded by black people. It's for black people. There's a mobile app for Muslims that's under development. So Uber and Lyft won't be the rideshare apps of the future, because we are the kind of society that when left to our own devices, we create our own, separate and apart from each other. Because that's the kind of world we live in. That if you give us an opportunity or a chance, we actually don't want to engage each other because we're too different. You know, you're taller than I am, you're shorter than I am, your hair looks different from mine, you speak in a way that my family doesn't speak. And so when, without other forces that compel us to come together, that compel us to interact, we would actually build worlds unto ourselves. We have such forces or engines. One of them is education. Schools require us to come together. Schools like North Cross require us to come together regardless of our age, our political affiliation, our social class. We come together, we learn together, and we learn through that exchange. Well, we called up one of the ride shares to get a driver to bring us to Roanoke. And I have to tell the story the way it happened. So the driver was lost on campus at Virginia Tech, a big place. So he was in a blue PT Cruiser. And so I called him up. And I could tell from the way he sounded, he's probably an older gentleman, not in high school. And so he said, I'm here, I'm near the building, but I'm a bit lost. We look across looking for a blue PT Cruiser, we find it. He makes his way there. I did not notice this because I was trying to hurry to get here. So I just could imagine, you know, like you all sitting here waiting with your, you know, thumbs, twiddling your thumbs, like, where in the world's our speaker? So I was focused on getting my bag into the car when one of the members of our team turned to me and said, the Uber driver has on a Make America Great Again hat. Now, I just showed you who the three people were who were about to get into the car. And it wasn't until I stopped for a moment and said, let me look at this hat to make sure that what you said, because you could, I mean, some hats look like they say Make America Great Again, but it actually says, like, watch me twerk. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's red, it's got the same color in and all that kind of stuff. So I'm sitting there like, okay, let me just take a look and see if this is the right hat. Sure enough, it's the Make America Great Again hat. Now, I have to tell you what I feel when I see a Make America Great Again hat. But you have to appreciate the fact that just because I feel this way does not mean you have to feel this way. That's the beauty about living in democracy. We don't have to feel the same way or even feel the same emotions when we see the hat. But you know what? Just like you have the right to feel a certain way about that hat, I also get to feel a certain way. The beautiful thing about democracy when it's done well is I can stand here and safely tell you how I felt. And in the moment, I felt like I can't get in this car. I've got to get to Roanoke, but I can't get in this car. But there's a problem. I'm already in the car. And the car is taken off, and it's really unsafe to jump out of moving cars. I didn't pick that up when I was in school. So how do you get to Roanoke in a car with a person who's wearing something that makes you feel unsafe. When it's unsafe, probably even dangerous, life-threatening, for you to jump out of the classroom. Here's the answer. You stay in the car. And you do something that I think Black history has done nothing but taught us how to do it. You face your fear. You look at the hat that causes all sorts of fear for you in creation. You know, like, this person doesn't like me. You say, you know what? I'm in the car. He's in the car, and we're going to have the conversation. Because if I've learned nothing from Black history, I've learned that people who look like me, who are the fun size and have crazy hair, know how to sit somewhere and have a conversation with somebody. So I don't draw my weapon, I draw on my strongest weapon. That's my mind. And the words that I learned in high school, just like this, called Kempsville High School, I figured out, how do I articulate for the guy at the front what I'm feeling right now? How can I do it in a way that he doesn't feel like I'm a threat to him? And our strongest words, my friends, are what our teachers give us. It's a vocabulary. It's the words, the phrases, the questions. It's not just a test. Don't just take the test to master the test. Take the test to master the question. How do you form it? How do you ask people for information that you don't have access to, but you need it? Most importantly, in all that getting, get an understanding. That's paraphrasing Christian scripture. This really powerful lesson for Black History Month, because in that car, my two colleagues can tell you, we crossed politics, we crossed identity issues, we crossed religion, history, education. It was education, the education that you're getting, that prepared each of us for that moment to have a conversation with our fellow brother. The guy in the hat is our fellow brother. And it was education and teachers and principals and assignments that gave me the words to talk to somebody who could at one point scare me. And by the end, he himself is fighting back tears because he can't even articulate exactly how do we find ourselves in this moment where who's in the White House and who you supported and who you voted for can be so divisive. And actually, the issue I'm learning more and more today, more than ever, is not who you voted for. More importantly, it's what do you believe? What are your values? What are your standing table issues for you? You're here for a reason in high school. And in February 1926, a guy by the name of Carter G. Woodson, who also, by the way, had a doctorate, Black man, decided to devote the second week in February to become Black History Week. Because what he realized is what we just witnessed is impossible for me to confront my fear, whether it's wearing a hat or something else, without me knowing my own history. But I actually couldn't sit in the car and talk to someone who talks about the Constitution as a staple document that should not be touched unless I can talk to them about the conflicts, the frustrating points there, that in fact that the Constitution had never moved. I couldn't be your keynote speaker today. If the Constitution was not a living document, those of you in here who have friends who are different races, especially Black friends, would not have Black friends. You wouldn't have Black teachers and Black classmates if the document got to dictate to us what democracy was. Black history to me is more than February, of course, but it's more than February, it's more than this talk. Black history, my history, is your history. It's our history. And we all have to know it and master it. Because without it, our history is incomplete. In fact, your understanding of yourself is incomplete until you also appreciate Black history. All of our histories matter. And Carter G. Woodson was so convinced of this point. Carter G. Woodson, born December 19th, 1875. Carter G. Woodson, I love talking about Carter G. Woodson because I'm from Virginia Beach, Virginia. And Carter G. Woodson was born in Smithfield, Virginia, which is not that far from Virginia Beach, well, from the East Coast kind of area of Virginia. And he was born there, Smithfield, also known New Canton, Virginia. Carter G. Woodson was an educator. He was a teacher, ultimately became a principal. Education for him was exciting because when Carter G. Woodson was sort of impacted by poverty, that is, he didn't know what the rest of the world looked like. It was education that exposed him to Europe first. It was education that exposed him to where he could go, to what the world could be like. That education for him was liberation. It freed him from the shackles of poverty. It freed him from the shackles of New Canton, Virginia. So much so that he started reading. Reading is fundamental, but he started reading about the contributions of African Americans to society. Did the same thing as a teacher, did the same thing as a principal. In this book that he wrote called Miseducation of the Negro, Carter G. Woodson talks about his love for learning. How many of you in here, by a show of hand, absolutely love learning? You love it. You put it, throw yourself into your assignments. Hold on to it, preserve it. It's part of Black History Month, it's part of Black history, it's part of our history. A passion for learning. If there's something that you don't know how to do today, that you want to know how to do, never back down to the challenge of learning something new. My best example of this is my maternal grandmother. I'm going to talk about her several times throughout the talk today. But my grandmother, my mom's mom, born Creola Evelyn Warner, coolest thing ever, right? My grandmother was born October 6th. 1925. October 6, 1925. Roll forward, February of 1926. She wouldn't even been a year old yet. Carter G. Woodson inaugurates Black History Week. My grandmother was born right around the time that Black History Week started. My grandmother was a public school teacher just like Carter G. Woodson. 50 years in the public school teacher, retired on a Friday and went right back to work on Monday as a substitute teacher. Dies as a substitute teacher who's so committed to teaching and learning because she too believed that education was transformative, it was liberating, it's our only hope to a brighter future. So my maternal grandmother, I watched her all her life learn Creola Evelyn Warner. I called her Mum. When I was growing up, Mum would ask me, she lived in Trenton, North Carolina. I lived in Virginia Beach, Virginia. That's like 4 hours away from each other. So when I would go visit my grandmother, I would take my laptop, my grandmother, or my computer, whatever it was, and my grandmother would say, "Hey baby, what you working on that laptop?" I would say, "Mom, I'm doing my assignment." She was like, "Okay, get your lesson out." That's what she would tell me. Always get your lesson out. I'm going to do my homework. So one day, my grandmother, I remember working on the computer, she was leaning over me, watching. I could see her shadow sort of over the screen. She said to me, "Rel, what are you doing on, what's that right there?" I said, "That's called the internet." I said, "Actually, that's not the internet. It's like a browser through which I access the internet." And my grandmother, at like 80 years old, said, "One day I'm gonna get on the internet too, baby." So what I did was, when I finished my doctorate, this woman had made so many sacrifices for me. For instance, I don't know if it's gonna play, but like, I can do this. And I just walk by a piano and I just touch it. And my mom says, "Who touched the piano?" I'm like, "No one." And my mom said, "You're a liar. That was you. Don't touch that piano. We can't afford you to touch that piano. Get on a break here." You know, like moms do. So she's getting like using it. And I'm sitting there like, you know, shaking. And my grandmother turns to, remember, my grandmother's a master teacher. My grandmother turns to her daughter and says, "Man, don't talk to him like that." I'm like, "Yeah." And she turns to me and she says, "Hey, Rail, do you want to play the piano?" I said, "Yes, ma'am." And my mom said, "Well, I don't know why you're asking him that, because we don't have the money for a piano." She said, "That's all right, I'm going to make the sacrifice." I said, "Yeah." You know, so my mom said, "Well, where are you going to find the money?" My brother said, "You know what, if we can't find the money, then we'll have to figure out a way to make some." Education opens your mind to the possibilities. If you don't have it today, that's okay, because education always keeps you optimistic about your abilities to make some, that you'll find a way or make some. So my grandmother, remember, my mom said, "Well, if he's gonna take piano lessons, he needs a piano." I can't afford a piano. My grandmother said, well, I can't afford it. I just had to make the sacrifice. I didn't know what sacrifice was, but I knew I was getting a piano. This was kind of cool, right? And my mom said, well, what are you going to do? My grandmother said, now turn y'all's heads. I got to go to the bank. And she reached in her bank. Called it a $5,000 bill. I don't even know what it was, but she got me a piano. Before you know it, I'm in lessons, and those lessons led me to learn the piano so much so that I don't know if I play that. When I needed to make money, I was able to play for churches or play for someone's wedding until I found my why, like what I'm supposed to do in life. It was the skills that I acquired, the education that got me there. My maternal grandmother made sacrifices so I could have skills. So when I finished my doctor, I was like, what could I do for this woman who had done so much for me? I decided, she always wanted a computer, so I got her a computer. So I said, Mom, I'm going to buy you a computer. I bought her a computer, set it up for her, polished it off. And she came and she said, honey, that is a good-looking computer. Now, one day, I'm going to turn it on. And then she walked in. And a year later, I realized she had never turned the piano on. I said, Mom, I got you this great computer you're not going to use. She said, all right, honey, come on, I'm going to use it. I said, well, what do you want to do on your computer? She said, I want to buy me a frock. That's a dress. I said, where do you want to go? She said, you know where I go, J.C. Penney's. So I said, all right, sit down. And she sat down at the computer, and I turned it on. It was a PC, so it took forever to turn on. It's okay. So it took forever to turn on. Finally, it's on. And then she says, well, what do I have to do first? I said, well, what you have to do is you have to go to the Safari, Internet Safari. So we opened up Safari, typed in there, J.C. Penney's. Hit return, waited for 3 seconds. And then told her, okay, so now just look around J.C. Penney's website or Internet Explorer. Good. Thank you for that. He's like, you can't look at Safari on a PC. I suppose I don't touch PCs, but my girl has a PC. It's like a collector's item now, but fine. So I told her, Internet Explorer, go there, look around J.C. Penney's website, find something. I went and made coffee, came back and I said, Ma, did you find a frock? She said, honey, I found a frock, a hat, and a purse. I said, okay. I said, now, remember what we're talking about. Never back down to the challenge of learning. Learning is emancipatory, sets us free. W.B. Du Bois tells us that it's actually one of our greatest gifts is the gift of learning. The fact that if we don't know it today, we can know it tomorrow because we have the ability to learn. My grandmother could have said, I don't want to touch this computer. She could have said, no, honey, I'm just going to keep driving down to J.C. Penney's. But even at the age of 80, my grandmother, like all of us who raised our hand, has a passion for learning, a love for learning, like Carter G. Woods. And she says, I found me a hat, a purse, and a dress. And I said, okay, so here's what you gotta do. When you're in this is my grandmother here at the computer on the side. I said, so when you're in the store and you find something you want, you get it off the shelf, and where do you put it? Where do you put it? In the cart. So my grandmother said, exactly. So I said, now find the dress. And you see that button that says add to cart? Click add to cart. She clicked add to cart. She said, Lord, where did that dress go? I said, it's in the cart. It's okay. See at the top, it says one item. That's your dress. I said, now go find your hat and your purse. And she went and found the hat. She said, don't even tell me. I know what to do. Add to cart. Now let me go find this hat. You know, I think I'm going to get both of these hats. And before you know it, she's got all that in her cart. I said, okay, now, when you're in the store, you have everything in the cart that you want, and it's time to check out. I gave it away. I said, it's time to go. What do you want to do? She said, check out. Okay, it's time to check out. Click check out. She said, now, do I need my credit card? I said, yeah, you're going to need your credit card so you can put it into the machine. She said, well, turn your head. I got to go back to the bank. And she reaches down and she gets her credit card from her safe deposit box. Sure enough, she types in the numbers. Does everything she has to do, and then she clicks submit. And before you know, she said, now what do I do? I said, just wait, and soon it'll be delivered to you. That year, I went to Trenton, North Carolina, where my grandmother lived, for what she calls Friends and Family Day at her church. My grandmother was a choir worker. She was always a very regal woman. She would walk into the church, and everybody said, oh, look at her, she's so lovely and beautiful. She was the church mother. So I remember, everyone sort of always appreciating what my grandmother had on. Proud woman, proud of her family, proud of what she'd been able to do in life. But that particular Sunday, when she put on the dress that she purchased off the internet, I noticed that when she walked into the church, there was like a little extra step. You know, she would pause for a moment. Normally she'd just walk to her seat, you know, just shashay. But this time, it's like she was marching to her seat. You know, it got to stop every time. And people were like, oh, look at this woman in her dress. And she turned to my Aunt Della, who's like 8 years her senior. So Aunt Della's like 88 and said, Creola, girl, that dress is gorgeous. My grandmother looked at her and said, honey, I bought this dress off the internet. And my Aunt Della said, you shop on the internet? She said, honey, you don't shop on the internet. When we embrace our love for learning, when we dare not be afraid of the challenge of learning, our confidence soars. We've known this for quite a bit of time. Confidence, self-efficacy, has three levers. First of it is verbal persuasion. You may not ride a motorcycle today, but if I told you you could ride a motorcycle, you're actually feeling a little bit more convinced I could possibly do it. Verbal persuasion. You may not be making straight A's right now, but you can make straight A's. Each and every one of you can make straight A's. And simply by telling you that, you're more likely to believe that it's possible. Whatever class is giving you struggles or challenge you right now, you may not even know your own history and know anything at all about Black history, but simply telling you you could, you can do it. You can learn it. You can learn a new skill. You can master math. You can balance formulas. All of these things, these skills, verbal persuasion simply raises your confidence and your ability to complete that assignment. Second, it's vicarious experiences. I don't have to just tell three of you that you can ride a motorcycle. The other thing I can do is show you someone riding a motorcycle. And if I tell you you can ride a motorcycle, and then you watch someone ride a motorcycle, you're like, now wait a second, I know I can do this. If they can ride the motorcycle, I know I can ride the motorcycle. Vicarious experiences. This is why, have you ever read anything or seen on social media where people say that you are the average of the five friends you keep around you? Anybody ever seen that? You are the average of the five folks around you. The reason why is because we are human beings. We are impressionable. And we are actually influenced by those around us. Have you ever gone to the gym or gone running or played your favorite video game alone and been okay with like losing, having a lower score, being in the gym and just walking on the treadmill, but the moments, you see what I'm saying? Yeah, the moment someone else is present, you're like, you know, we try to keep up with them because we are impressionable. We are social beings, we are impressionable, we are influenced by other people. Vicarious experiences drive us. So if you simply watch someone else do something, it's more likely that you're going to do it. That's why you want to always check your friend Rolodex and ask yourself, who do I have around me? You know, do I have people? I see you looking around, just keep looking straight. Don't look at the people beside you right now. But this is probably a good thing to have around you, right? Because you're all in school. You seem to be pretty well motivated. But if you're ever in a place where you're like, why is it that I'm thinking I'm striving for success, but I don't feel like I have any support? Or it's hard for me to hold on to my goals. You have to check who you have around you because we are impressed by those who are around us. We are influenced by them. Always keep people around you who are driven, motivated, who have a core sense of themselves. Values to which they hold. Carter G. Woodson talks about the fact that education, one of the things about education is liberating. But the other thing he says is that it's a social process that we learn through our exchange with each other. My ideas get better because of you. It's when you challenge me and say, hey, Terrell, I like your idea, but you push it a bit further. So who's cultivating your ideas? Who's nourishing your ideas? Who's telling you that what you're thinking about is a good idea or a bad idea, giving you honest feedback? All these things are critically important. My grandmother was one who helped me understand the core elements of confidence. Third, verbal persuasion, vicarious experiences, and third is mastery experiences. Is what Carter G. Woodson talked about when he said that in terms for us to learn, quite often, we have to sit down and confront the challenge. Sit down and confront the challenge. I started with a story that demonstrated that. You have to sit down and confront the assignment. Confront the math problem. Confront the English assignment. the paper we must write. Who in here absolutely loves to write? It's your, one of your favorite. Now, keep your hands up, high, high, high. Good, good, good. Now, hands down. Who in here, I know, safe space, we're gonna build it, trust me, right? Who in here does not like to write? I mean, you would rather sing your assignments to your math professor versus write them down. Yeah. So, here's what we're gonna do. You have to think about this. As you evolve as a learner, we always are willing to rush and do, to quickly take up the things that we know we are good at. If you know you're gonna experience success, no pressure. I'll do it. You know, if someone said to me, "Hey, Terrell," so today we were at Virginia Tech, and someone asked me on a whim, "Will you sing for us?" I absolutely said yes. I will sing. Why? Because I like to sing. And if, even if everyone in the room said, "You're sounding terrible," I know I'm going to have a fun time doing it because I love to sing. I sing in the shower. I sing with my mouth open. I sing when I'm asleep. So no matter what, you know, I sing a lot. Same thing. So I'm not backing down to that challenge because, one, I enjoy singing. Two, I've had feedback from people over time, and the weight of the feedback is not that I can't sing. So the odds of me experiencing success in that moment were on the uptick. It's significantly likely that I would be able to do something that someone would enjoy. So without hesitation, I did it. However, there are things in my life that I don't always experience success with. There are things in life, my life, that I experience as a challenge. And when invited to do those things, I'd much more quickly get on the stage and speak to an audience or sing a song or do something that I know I'm going to experience success in. But actually, this is what we learned. That we stymie our development, our growth, our ability to be our optimal selves when we always back down from challenge. Embrace challenge. Embrace the things that make you nervous. Confront those things that you are afraid of. And understand that education provides the tools for you to confront that challenge. Mastery experiences is that opportunity to confront that challenge. So I tell the story about when I was, after I turned 25, 27, something like that, I decided I was going to spend some time in the gym. So I go to the gym. I go to the gym to run because you can't tell I have super duper huge muscles. I just left them in a suitcase. But I went to the gym and I said, all I'm going to do when I go to this gym is I'm going to run. And although I just told you all that we are social people, influenced by those around us, I thought I could get a membership to the gym, go to the gym, and simply run on the treadmill with my iPod in my ear. All I do is run, look at everybody else doing what they're doing, and then I'm going to leave, and I'm going to go back, and I would just keep my legs and my body strong. But after I get to the gym, in walks a guy who looks just like me, and by that I mean he was just black. He was 6'2", probably like 300 pounds, looked nothing like me at all. I mean, he was African American. We didn't share that in common, which in this society, for a lot of people, is all that you need to say that people look alike. That's why we need Black history. Because Black history teaches you the nuances and the flavor and the different ancestral origins that all Black people share ultimately in common, but our trajectory, our movement into this country, and therefore our experiences in this country can make us quite different. Black history, week, turn, month, is that time we could really throw ourselves into literature and reading about our collective history so we don't make statements like they look exactly the same. But here I'm in this gym, I'm looking at my brother, and he walks in, and he goes over to this bench, and he sits down on the bench, and he puts some silver ball, like circular stuff, on this pole, right? And he has on gloves, which is so cool. Anybody who wears, that's why I always love Michael Jackson, because anybody who wears a glove in public is like just gonna get points with me. So this guy has on gloves, he puts these silver things on this pole, and then he gets ready to get up to the bar, and he gets on the bench, and then he hops up immediately, looks at himself in the mirror, and does like this. And then he gets back under the bar. And while running, which is what my motivation was, right? My only motivation for getting a gym membership was to do what? Run. And here I am doing what I'm supposed to be doing, but watching my twin brother, who is now lifting weights. And you know what I started thinking? That looks so cool. I would want a glove. Oh my gosh, look at him throwing all that weight. I need to lift weights. You know what? Enough. And I leave the gym that night, and I go to Dick's Sporting Goods, and I tell the guy at Dick's Sporting Goods, I think his name was Mike or Matthew, I'm going to lift weights, and I need gloves. In fact, what I did was, I'm really good at this, I know you all too, I can like take pictures of anybody, but they don't even know it, right? So here I am running in the gym, like a little creep watching this other guy, and I'm like, right? So I go to Matthew, I'm like, Matthew, I've got to lift weights, and this is what I need to look like right here, okay? So I need like the gloves, I need the socks, the headbands, the wristband. And Matthew knows the one on me. I told him my favorite color is red, so I get red wristband and hatband and socks and shoes and everything I need. I'm like redheaded, so look a hot mess for the gym, right? So go right into the gym the next night, and I sit there and watch. I'm like, okay, so I need a bar. That's easy enough, so I get a bar. It's really heavy, but that's fine. Then I get these little circular things, and I just grab, he had two on each side. So I just grab two circle things and put them on the side. Don't laugh, it's a safe space. Come on now, this is my circle. I put up two more, and I put them on the other side, and then I sit down, and I get under the bar, and I'm like, oh my gosh. And then I get back under the bar. And I begin to do my weight routine. So I'm here. Actually, I'm gonna show you this. You need to see this, the way that it transpired in the gym. So, I'm on the bar, and I remember when the guy before, my twin brother, lifted, he just went like this, right? So I'm like lifting, by the way, they're really heavy. Weights are really weighty, it turns out, maybe thus the word, right? So I pick up the bar, I'm trying to move it, and I'm pushing, and so I'm like, okay, well, I'm just going to use everything that's going to get the bar up, and I, you know, I'm a man of faith, and I'm here at North Cross High School, so I don't know, I'm speaking to students of different faith, but for me, I'm like, come on, Jesus, help me, get the bar up, and right when I called his name, the bar kind of lifted. You know why? Because we are all stronger than we will ever give ourselves credit for. It's when I thought I couldn't lift the bar. I might have had to kick my feet. It may have taken everything that's within me. But the moral of that story is the bar did get lifted. And you've got to remember that you are stronger than your greatest challenge. Math can't stop you. It may take longer for you to complete the assignment, but you will complete the assignment. It may take you longer to get through the paragraph, but who cares? Because the person who's passing you is not always your competition. Sometimes you've got to compete with yourself and say, you know what, I'm reading faster than I was last year. And that's a good victory for me. Before you know it, here I am, I got the bar up, and I'm like, yes! Wait! Oh my God, it's heavy. How do you get it down? So here I am, it's up, and I'm like trying to like celebrate that, but now it's about to come down. So I'm like, okay. And I'm trying to ease it down on the bar. And just in the middle of me trying to get it back on the bar, have you ever had a time where like you're walking or you've been sitting for a long time and you get up and you realize that your leg is like, it's there, but doesn't feel like it's there? And it's like, you're like, whoa, this is weird. Like, this leg just doesn't exist. It's there, but it just doesn't. So I'm sitting here, and I'm lifting this bar, and while the bar is coming down, my left arm decides it wants to leave my body. I mean, it's there, but you can't feel it. So, like, the bar is coming down, and all of a sudden, it's like a noodle. And so I'm sitting here, and I'm like, oh my gosh, the bar is about to fall. And I hear the door of the gym open, but I'm not sure what's going to happen. And just before I say, Jesus, take the wheel! And I thought the bar would crush my throat, and like the headline would say, Professor killed in gym. And like all of my students would carry like little weights or something like that. And when I opened my eyes, I thought, but I'm not hurting. Like I don't feel pain. I don't feel like I'm dead. But I remember growing up with my grandmother in her church, they would always say, like, when you die and go to heaven, there will be no more pain. So I'm like, this is heaven. Heaven has a gym. This is here. And actually, when I opened my eyes, I wasn't dead. I wasn't in heaven. heaven, the God who I had watched the night before had made his way into the gym and had just caught the bar before it crushed my throat and killed me. And I opened my eyes and I looked at him and I'm like, what are you doing? I had that. He's like, no, you didn't. He said, why are you trying to lift weights? I said, well, quite frankly, I mean, you were lifting weights. See, I saw you yesterday. Where did those pictures come from? I mean, like you. Turns out, he says, what do you do for a living? I said, I'm a professor. He said, you know what I do for a living? I said, no. What? He said, I'm a bodybuilder. He asked a profound question. Why is a professor trying to do with a bodybuilder? Because if you're not careful, that's what the world will do to you. It will have you chasing people who are actually not chasing you. It will have you trying to be like someone who's not your competition. It will have you, the artist, competing now with the musician. It will have the musician competing now with the spoken word artist. It will have the spoken word artist trying to be like the biologist. It will have the hair designer trying to be the one who makes the t-shirts. Why in the world are we competing with each other when in fact we need each other to work together? It's what Black history, our history, can teach us. And there's always been a division of labor. There's always been a particular path for each of us. And for me, it was in that gym that I realized I got to stop letting the world tell me I'm supposed to be big, because there, although I'm one size, there are moments, what's your name?
Toby,
there are moments when I feel like I'm like 6'7". I do. I'm so short. But some moments when I step into my why, when I step into what I know I'm supposed to do, the lane is big and the birds are chirping and the sun is outshining and everything is great because I'm optimally myself. But then there are other times when I, you know, someone says, oh my gosh, you're really funny. You should be a comedian. But the problem is I'm not a comedian. I might be a funny professor or even a funny looking professor. But the professor can't be the comedian. And the comedian can't be the professor. So we all have to use education and educated moments like this to figure out, what is our why? Where are you going? Why are you here? What's your purpose in life? You got lots of gifts. I was just at a campus the other day in Cincinnati, Ohio, and met students who said, Dr. Strayhorn, what do you do when you can do a lot of stuff? You got to pick one? That's not my answer. My answer is to figure out how do you use all the good strengths that you have, all the skills you have, in service to whatever your why is, your purpose. And you'll figure out in life at some point in time that what you're supposed to do will draw on all of those strengths in different ways. That's what education is all about. To me, I think that Black History Month is a time for us to come together to not only celebrate the contributions of African Americans, not just Martin Luther King, although Martin Luther King is a phenomenal civil rights leader, social activist, theologian, educator, orator. Martin Luther King, I have a tweet that is put out about him a few weeks ago. He says one time that our lives begin to end the day we become silent about things that matter. Black history matters. Our history matters. Your life matters. And the day you become silent, whether it's an Uber driver, or it's a friend at school, or it's someone in your neighborhood, you become silent about yourself and your experiences and who you are and why you dress the way you dress and talk the way you talk and why your family acts and behaves or organizes the life, your life, the way you do, your life begins to end. But the moment you activate your agency, open your mouth and speak up, confront the challenge, use all the education has taught you to do so, your life begins to flourish, your life begins to thrive, your life begins to open up. My maternal grandmother was the one who reminded me of those 3 points: verbal persuasion, mastery experiences, and vicarious experiences. She would teach me those things, not those words. My grandmother didn't talk like that. My grandmother would say things like, oh, I remember, I was 6 years old in her kitchen. She was making breakfast when her phone rang. She said, Brenda, get the phone for me. I answered and said, hello. And the person on the other end, she was my cousin, said, I want to speak to your grandmother. So I said, Mom, the phone's for you. And my grandmother, whenever she answered her phone, you know, on my other iPhone, not like I have 2 iPhones, my old iPhone before I replaced it, there was like recordings of my grandmother. That's why I can't get rid of it. The recordings of my grandmother when she was alive on that phone. And whenever my grandmother answered the phone, she would say, good evening. Watch my feet. Good morning. She always like got up on her toes while she was. Even at 88, I would watch her just struggle to put all the effort in the world into her greeting, because she would always tell us it's how you greet a person that starts the conversation. If you start on the upbeat, they don't have an option but to keep going up. But if you start like, hello, or what do you want? I mean, we do it all the time, right? Not here at North Cross. I'm talking about other high schools where you can answer what they say. Or, you know, in their phone have, why would I answer? That's your name in your contact list, right? You know, why would I answer? Hate them. Can't stand this one. Delete it. So my friend would do that kind of stuff. Everybody in the car, how she would say, good morning, good evening. So she said good morning, and then the conversation went something like this. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. That last one lets us know that the conversation is going to a level that she does not enjoy. She gets off the phone. She goes back to make breakfast. I said, Mom, are you okay? She said, not right now, honey, but I'm going to be. I said, how do you know you're going to be? She said, because I need you to help me. I said, anything for you, Mom. She said, I need you to sing a song on Sunday. I said, anything but that. I said, don't sing. I'm like seven. And she said, but the woman who's going to sing the song, she's not going to be there on Sunday. I need you to sing. And I said, well, the good news is I don't sing. She said, well, you know what's so cool about that, son? Or Rail? I said, what's that? She said, you're in my house. And anybody who's in my house is going to do anything. I say that you do have an option. You can get out. But I'm like 7 years old. You can't get out of 7 years old. So other people are like, okay, it sounds like I'm going to be singing. What song am I going to be singing on Sunday? She said, the name of the song is This Little Light of Mine. I said, well, the good news is I don't even know that song. So you got to find someone else. She said, no, I'm going to teach you the song because I believe you can do it. Verbal persuasion. She said, here's how it goes, honey. And then she sang it while flipping pancakes, frying bacon, and making grits with no butter on it, just like I like it. My grandmother sang This Light of Mine in full voice, vicarious experience. She showed me how it was done. Then she said, now, Rel, you do it. I said, oh, Ma, I don't want to do it. She said, just go ahead and give it a try, baby. I said, no, I don't want to do it. And she said, come on, Rel, just do it for Ma. I said, Ma, please don't. She said, do it! Grits spilled everywhere, right? And I did like most people who don't want to do something and don't want to embrace challenge and don't want to draw upon all the skills that education equip us with to try new things and learn new things. I did it stubbornly and said, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Whoa. She let me get through the whole song. She said, you sound terrible. But you know what? You are going to sing that song on Sunday. And when you sing it, you're not going to sound like that. Because no grandson of mine is going to go into church and embarrass me sounding like you sound right now. Not the way I'm going to work with you, and you're going to have practice. You're going to practice every single day. You know, that's what she let me do. I mean, I got in her church on Sunday. I was like, oh, Lord, please let my grandma disappear. Or let the choir fall off the face. Whatever you bring your 7 years old and don't want to do something, right? And sure enough, she gets up to direct the choir. She's looking great. And the musician goes over to the piano. They start playing the song like, I think that's that song. And she looks over me and she says, come on, I'm in the back. And I'm like, no. She's like, come on, baby. And I'm like, no. She's like, no. Because I wouldn't be here as your speaker if I had not done that. And so I get up there and I do just like a 6-7-year-old who hasn't practiced, who's stubborn, who doesn't want to embrace challenge, who doesn't know what's inside of me, has never confronted anything that's different in my life at that point. And my grandmother says, sing. And I was like, I don't know if I can do this. And what I did was I broke down crying. And you know what's cool? When you're 7 years old and you lack confidence and you cry, people clap. They're like, aww! Like if I got up here right now and when they called my name, I got up and said, rah! People clap for me, it doesn't happen. But you get like the adult side, not the adult side, but be some adult. Right? So I get in front of her whole entire church and start crying, they start clapping. And most people would say, you know, like go to the baby and say, go ahead and have your seat, it's okay. Not my grandmother. She went over and she said, you can do this. I'm like, look at me, I'm crying. She said, no, baby, you can do it. Close your eyes and sing for Mom. Had she said sing for Snoopy, I would still be sitting there. Had she said sing for, you know, someone who I didn't know, I probably wouldn't have been compelled to do it. But she said sing for Mom, somebody who I love. Someone who I had a relationship with. And before you know it, I just sort of believed her without thinking about it. I remember closing my eyes and grabbing my blazer, this was probably the blazer I had on when I was 17, and saying, "This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine." And my grandmother said, "Do the second verse." I'm like, "You didn't teach me the second verse." I had to sing the first verse all back over. Because that's what happens when we confront the challenge that's before us. When we stop worrying about what's outside of us, the noise, the haters, the distractions, the stereotypes, what's happening in society, the politics, and we turn inward to the strength that lies within. What my grandmother did that day was she introduced me to someone I had never met before, a voice that I had never met before, that all of a sudden, it was possible for me to do what she had asked me to do. If nothing else, I hope you leave this Black History Month understanding that you are stronger than your greatest challenge. What you need to overcome that challenge partly lives right inside of you. The other part is what you're receiving from education. I talked a lot about my grandmother. I closed with my grandmother by request. So I don't have my grandmother anymore with me. Not physically. But November 1st, 2013, I was in Virginia Beach, Virginia, at PF Chang's. You know what that is, PF Chang's? Mm-hmm. Restaurant, Chinese restaurant. It's just one of my favorite places to eat. Every now and then I see PF Chang's, I think about my grandma. November 1st, we were there. And my grandmother, she lives in Trenton, North Carolina. They don't have a PF Chang's there. They only have Piggly Wiggly. You know what that is? It's a grocery store. I was in Nashville, Tennessee, speaking at Vanderbilt. Gave a fun lecture. Sun was shining, birds were chirping. I walked right outside of Vanderbilt University. It took me to lunch. We were walking down the street, and while walking, I looked over, and there's a Piggly Wiggly in Nashville, Tennessee, across from Vanderbilt, and I just broke down crying. It made me think about my grandmother. I'm not crying because I'm sad. I'm crying because, gosh, what a gift that each of us have. People who impact us in ways that even when they're gone, you are strengthened by what they've given us. In fact, education, in the Latin, is educare. In the Greek, it's educare, with a Y. It simply means to draw out that which is within. My grandmother was a master teacher. I don't say that because it's like an award that's on her wall, although she had plenty of awards. I say it because if nothing else, my grandmother taught me how to turn inward and draw out that light, the stuff that I need to see that's within. We were in P.F. Chang's. My grandmother had never been to P.F. Chang's. We sat down. She said, "Hey, Rel, you've never been to P.F. Chang's. What should I order to eat?" Now, my sister, she grew up in the same house. You ever have these brothers or sisters who grew up in the same house? She's just kind of different from each other. And so, my grandmother's in this restaurant. She's like, "I've never been to P.F. Chang's. What should I order?" And I'm like, "Oh, you never been to P.F. Chang's? What I would order." And my sister said, "Wait, you never been to P.F. Chang's? You've never been to P.F. Chang's? How in the world do 88 years old and you've never been to P.F. Chang's? I've never met anybody." And I'm like, "Him." Yeah. Finally get her to quiet down. Stop making my grandmother feel bad. By the way, we all do this. Make people feel bad because they haven't had certain experiences. The part of Black history is celebrating and appreciating diversity. And part of that is understanding that everybody is not gone where you've gone, but everyone can go where you go. And in fact, you can take them there. You don't have to take them there physically. You can take them there with your reflections, your stories, your pictures, your social media posts. Remember, we all have a social responsibility to get us there. As Martin Luther King said, we will not get there until we all get there. So if my grandmother said, "You never been to P.F. Chang's? No problem. My favorite thing to eat at P.F. Chang's is lemon chicken." She turns to the waiter and says, "Honey, I'm going to have lemon chicken because my favorite grandson told me to have it." She said it in front of my brother and my sister. So I was like, "I'm sold. I didn't need to eat it. It's a great day now. For for me. We had a great meal. We went outside. We took pictures with my grandmother. We left November 2nd, 2013. I got on a plane, went back to Columbus, Ohio. November 3rd, they put my grandmother in a car, drove her back to Trenton, North Carolina. She made her way back there. When I was 6 years old, I told you my brother taught me this song, This Is Light of Mine. But when I was like 9 years old or 10 years old, somewhere a little bit older, my grandmother told me one day, she said, "Rel, now this one's my favorite song." I said, "Really? What's the word for this song?" Well, she said, "Now, honey, this one, not these words." She said, "The words are, there's a bright side somewhere. There's a bright side somewhere. Don't you give up until you find it. There's a bright side somewhere." I said, "All right, what's the rest of the words?" She said, "That's it, honey, that's all the words." That's my favorite song. Simple, but so, so real. And then she did just like she did all her life. She said, "Now this is how it goes." And while hanging clothes out on the line outside, she started singing, "There's a bright side somewhere." My grandma would chew on things, you know. You would never know exactly how a song goes because she would like elongate it by doing the real, real gospel version. "There's a bright side somewhere. Don't you give up until you find. There's a bright side somewhere." She would hang all the clothes out. She would say, "Now it's your turn, Rel, you sing it." And so I would sing it. And we would go to churches all over North Carolina, St. Philip's Temple and Free Will Baptist Church and Morris Chapel. And when we would go to the church, they'd say, "Miss Warner's here. We want Miss Warner to come up and sing a song." And she would, if I was with her, she would say, "Honey, I want you to go up there and sing with me." And I'd say, "Mom, what are we going to sing today?" Sometimes she would say, "Sing Amazing Grace. It's Black History Month." She would, "Amazing Grace. How sweet." Say, "Okay, well, we're not going to sing that one. What is it?" One of the other songs my brother loved to sing was "There's Not a Friend." "There's not a friend like the lonely Jesus. No, not one. No, not one." Sometimes I look at her and say, "Mom, what are we going to sing today?" She said, "Today, honey, you know what? I ain't got no arthritis. Mama feeling pretty good. Let's sing my favorite song." She never had to tell me, though, what her favorite song was, because I knew she meant there's a bright side somewhere. I called her November 4th. She didn't answer. Called her November 5th. She didn't answer. Called her November 6th, 2013, 1 month after her 88th birthday. No answer. I called my mom and said, "Hey, Mom, we got to send someone over to Mom's house to check on her because I've called her like 3 days and she's not answering my phone calls. She's also not returning my phone calls." We called my grandmother's house still to this day. The other week, her voicemail, still her voice. "Good morning. I'm sorry, honey. I'm not home." I said, "Mom, we got to send someone over to check on Mom because I called her and she's not answering, she's not returning her phone calls." My mom has a cousin who has he's gifted. He's gifted for getting into locked buildings. He's a talent. He's a natural talent. No, seriously. Like, he should manufacture the skill. He can get into anything. So my mom calls her gifted cousin and says, "Hey, look, I need you to go to my mom's house and get into it." He says, "Does she have a security alarm on?" My mom said, "Yes, she has a security system all over the house. Is that going to be a problem?" He said, "No, not at all." And so he goes to my grandma's house, and he uses his gifts, and he gets into the house, and he finds my grandmother at her kitchen table, stooped over, unconscious. He calls the paramedics who come, grab her, take her to the hospital, tell my cousin who has the gift, "If he hadn't called us, no telling what would happen." Last year I had a talk at a medical college. There's a whole group of paramedics right here who at this point in the story just broke down in tears. They didn't reveal themselves as paramedics. That each of us has a role to play. That's why your why is so important. And whether you want to be a paramedic or a doctor or a nurse or a lawyer or a spoken word artist, or a mom or a dad or a politician, go and be that thing because we need you, because it had not been for paramedics who got my grandmother to Craven County Community Hospital. Called my mom, who's a public health nurse, and said, "Hey, Linda, come see your mom. She suffered an aneurysm. And at the age of 88, there's not a whole lot we think we can do to her. My mom quickly went to go see her mom, goes to Craven County Community Hospital. She stays there for a few days. Then she calls her phone. She says, "Hey, Rel, how are you doing? I'm traveling across the country. Things going great." She said, "You should come to North Carolina to see your grandmother because she suffered an aneurysm. She's 88 years old. They don't think there's much they can do for her." So I got off the speaking circuit, went to go see my grandmother. Whenever I was in my grandmother's presence, as I told you, she was saying, she's like, "Good evening, good morning. Hey, Rel." So I got into the hospital, walked up to the third floor. I saw her name on the door, and I was like, "Oh, brace myself. I know she's gonna like be ready to greet me." And I hop into the door and say, "Hey, Mom." And the woman in the bed turned her head, looks at me, says nothing. Turns away, so I knew then my grandmother was already starting to leave us. I say I'm the fun size, my mom's the funner size. So I walk over to my fun size mom, who is my grandmother's only child. And have you ever seen someone who's like really on the verge of tears, and then you embrace them and they just lose it? And so I hugged my mom, who's the fun size, and before you know it, she let go, and all her weight is on me. I could feel her tears through my shirt. And I said, "Mom, you're so tired. Go home and rest." She said, "I can't go home and rest. I said, I got to take care of my mother." I said, "You don't have to take care of Mom. I'm here." She said, "Baby, you're not a nurse." I said, "No, I'm a doctor." So the doctor tells the nurse to go home, and the nurse listens. And what I did for the next couple of days is I took care of my grandmother. I washed her hair. I changed her diapers. I told the nurses, "Please don't make her eat if she doesn't want to eat." I told all the people coming to visit, "Shh, she's trying to rest." My grandmother's favorite singer was Shirley Caesar. I played her on my iPhone 4. And when it came time to go to bed at night, I sat right beside my grandmother and held her hand. The nurse came in and said, "Hey, do you want a cot? She can sleep on the cot and then you'd be more comfortable." I said, "I don't need to be comfortable as long as my grandmother's comfortable." Remember this, it may not make sense in high school, but when you get to college or after college or graduate school or wherever you're going to go, let me tell you, the currents of life are going to take you to great places. Keep going, don't stop, and remember, stay close to those you love. No matter how far you go in life, remember those who made the sacrifice for you to learn how to play the piano. Remember those who taught you the song in your kitchen before you ever had a stage to speak on. And dare to be at their side when they need you. So I'm sitting there holding my grandmother's hand, and I'm like, as long as she's comfortable, I'll be comfortable. And I drifted off to sleep. I woke up the very next day, did it all over again and all over again. And then I drifted off to sleep one night, and I was awakened by the most violent shaking of my grandmother's hand I ever remember in my life. And when we looked at the clock, it said 1:17 a.m., November 19, 2013, 1:17 a.m. I awakened, my grandmother's hand was shaking. I looked at her hand, I looked at her, she's looking me dead in the face. I said, "Mom?" And she looked at me and said, "My grandmother did not know what day of the week it was. She didn't know who the President of the United States was. She only had one kid. She could not recall her daughter's name. But November 19, 2013, 1:17 a.m., while shaking my hand, I'm looking at her face. I'm like, "Ma, are you okay?" And she said, "Hey, Rel." I said, "Mom, they're coming back." And so I'm reaching for the button to call the nurse, and while I'm reaching for the button to call the nurse, the TV pops on, wrong button. I'm looking around trying to find the phone to call the nurse. I'm so distracted by the things behind me. But it's, and what happens in my left ear, now at like 1:19 a.m., my grandma said, "Well, let's sing my favorite song. There's a bright side somewhere." Visiting hours were over, but my grandmother, who had not talked in weeks, was now singing. I forgot about the nurse. I remember just being there at the hospital. I said to my grandma, "There's a bright side somewhere. Don't you give up until you find." There's a bright side somewhere. And that was my last night with my grandma. Doing what we had done for so many years. Bless you, singing. It's been 3 years since my grandmother died, and I constantly think, why in the world was I the one who got the last chance to be with her? And in that last moment, she could have said a lot of things. She could have said, "Honey, I need you to know I'm proud of you. me something about history, but in the last moment, the last thing we did was sing. Because sometimes you gotta learn how to sing when nobody's watching. Sing when there's nobody around. Sing when there's no accompaniment. Sing when you don't even know the words. Sing when there's no melody. Sing when you know you won't get an award for it. But most importantly, sing about the light. Because there's a light in all of us. That's what Black History Month is all about. Thank you.